Thinking about your work and the Science of Learning Institute recently established at JHU, what are the current learning sciences focal areas? What new innovations or practices are being examined to help support the most effective learning for P20 students?
So I think that the science of learning here at Johns Hopkins is sort of right at the forefront of this new era of science of learning. And in fact, I think there's a lot of places where now this is becoming a sort of new approach. That is, people are starting to say, I think we need a Science of Learning Institute too. Well, and I think the reason for that is because there are some big, broad themes that are emerging as important research questions for understanding just the basic science of learning, but that people are also starting to see those big themes as having this application. And I think that, to me, is really where that's where the money is. That's where I want to be. What are some of those big sort of themes and ideas? One actually comes directly out of the education world, which is individualized learning. So individualized learning has become this buzzword. And for a while, I think people sort of said, oh, yeah, that sounds great, individualized learning. But what is it? What does it really mean? And I think that it's become sort of a unifying theme across the science of learning, because what it means to the sciences and to the individuals who are participating in this is it really does mean a focus on the individual as a learner and that learner's interaction with the environment. And what that does then is that has implications for all levels of analysis of a problem. So you can imagine that for someone like me who's worked in individual differences, now my work can speak directly to, well, if we know about the individual differences, that's going to feed what does it mean to approach a child with individualized learning? What does it mean to approach an adult who's reentering the workforce? So it has very broad sort of implications for education very broadly. In addition, it opens the door for questions about technology that go beyond just, hey, let's create a new technology, oh, this is going to help, but to start thinking about technology in ways that can adapt to an individual. So the adaptive learning work is very popular right now, both in more applied areas, but also in the basic sciences, and seeing those start to sort of come together and converge on ideas about how we actually could use technology to implement better and more effective learning for learners of all ages. So, you know, learning sciences has also really come to realize that learning is a lifelong process, and that while it's easy to think about formal education, this individualized learning really applies to, you know, learners across the age range. It also has implications for things like the design of classrooms. So architects and designers now sort of come into the fray for science of learning, because they have, you know, a whole field of design concepts that we can now start to tie to what we see as scientific evidence for how you want to design a space, and how you want to design a space differently for different groups of individuals, different individuals at different times. There's questions of implementation. So how do we actually think about taking the individualized learning approach to a classroom where you've got 30 kids? These are questions that we tend to think of as questions in the practice world, but there's an awful lot of work that can be done at all levels of analysis, from a laboratory to the classroom, to start to understand what that means to actually individualize learning in a group setting. But then the other side of it is that you can also drill down to much deeper levels. As soon as you start talking about individual differences and individualizing learning, you can start to talk about things like genetic factors that are involved. What are the biological factors involved? How do growth rates affect the way an individual actually approaches their learning situation? And what kinds of things do we need to think about in a learning situation, in the learning settings themselves, to not necessarily accommodate for, but to work with what the child is bringing to the table from all levels, from the genetic factors to the home environment, to the socioeconomics of their neighborhood, to the pressures of, the child who has to take a bus ride to school. We tend not to think about those things, but now we have this whole array of possible factors that all are going to contribute to this individual. And you need people working at many different levels to do that. So that's why I say that I think this individualized learning becomes this really unifying theme, because it gives questions to people at all the different levels. And if they're talking to each other, then hopefully the results can inform each other. And so that I think is sort of where this new science of learning and the idea of a science of learning institute really comes into play. Some of the other areas where I see sort of significant work underway that I think will really be of interest and needs to be really nicely disseminated to the education community broadly, and is perhaps, you know, this is where the students in doctoral programs are going to probably be the key to getting that information moving, are things like a focus on psychosocial factors. So I keep hearing in the education world the non-cognitive factors, and many of those non-cognitive factors are what in the cognitive sciences we would call psychosocial factors. We still call them cognitives, but that we would put them in this non-academic cognitive skills category. And I think there's a lot of focus on that in the education world. There's also an increased focus in that in the world, particularly of cognitive neuroscience, understanding, you know, why motivation plays such a critical role in something as simple as perception. You know, these kinds of things are starting to emerge as themes throughout the science of learning, and which is why we end up casting a very broad net for science of learning. I mean, it used to be people said, "No, that person studies visual perception." Well, visual perception is something that, you know, can't be ignored when you're trying to present material to a learner, and that's where things like the psychosocial factors and these, what, like I said, have been called some non-cognitive factors, come into play. The other area, as I mentioned before, is technology. And I think that there's a lot of work right now in the science of learning on, not on the technology itself. I think that's one area that's probably going to emerge quickly, because with children using iPads and iPhones and, you know, the accessibility, that we are going to see studies specifically on technology, and there are some. But in the science of learning, technology is being used to start asking questions such as, what is the role of self-pacing in learning? So there's a lot of work now on how putting an iPad in a child's hand and letting them sort of tracking their learning as they go and having the technology be adaptive, what is that doing for the learning? If we can make those kinds of things scalable, then I think that that's sort of going to play a really important role in getting some of the new technology to actually work in the learning settings. Another area that is very prominent in the science of learning is training your brain. So everyone knows about the websites now where you can go and train your brain. There's actually quite a bit of evidence behind some of them, and sifting through which ones are evidence-based and which ones are sort of, you know, taking advantage of a current fad is a little bit more challenging. But there's an awful lot of work on the fact that you can actually alter the brain and alter, more importantly, improve performance using very specific kinds of almost, you know, video games. I mean, now I am never going to be an advocate for let's put kids in front of a computer and play video games all day. That's just not a direction I think we ever want to go. But I do think that, you know, there's a lot of work now showing that certain kinds of games are actually enhancing attentional skills. We think visual spatial skills, although the jury's still out on that one. We know you can train those. Whether or not the games do it is one of my questions. The other aspect of that, in addition to sort of technology and this brain training, is that there's an increased question about manipulative. So how does actually working with the physical space and the physical world improve learning outcomes? And this is going on both at sort of a very basic level of science of just trying to understand what happens when children use different kinds of manipulatives, but also in the practice world on things like arts integration, opportunities to actually teach children using the physical body as a teaching tool. And I think we're starting to see now results that say this is probably a good thing. That is, you know, getting that engagement of the body and having the physical manipulations it is probably going to enhance learning in many ways. And so those are sort of topics that are coming both out of the basic sciences but are starting to infuse into practice as well. And I really think that that's a case where the basic science actually learned from practice, so really this backward give and take between things. I like this idea that the science of learning ultimately is really about this bidirectional relationship that goes all the way from very basic science to practice, and that it really is bidirectional. That the science is improving because the world of practice is informing it in very important ways. So each of those sort of give you sort of a smattering of things that I think are going on, and together I think they sort of suggest that we are making strides in terms of understanding how we make changes in, say, underlying brain function and behavior, and how that then might be used in ways that will be informative for education. And I think the other thing that the science of learning really should be on the radar of sort of every doctoral student is this notion of getting the evidence to practice. And that doesn't necessarily mean going to teachers and saying, oh, here's what you need to do, but just getting the information available to practice so that practice can then inform the science about how that might be useful. So I don't think, as scientists, we often don't know how our work might be useful. And the only way we're going to know that is by talking to practitioners, to really getting sort of out there in the field and understanding what's going on. And oftentimes, I find, at least in my own work, that I kind of get an idea that's sparked by something a teacher has said, or sparked by something I see in a classroom, or by, you know, students I've talked to, or children I've been watching at play. And I start to study it, and I get some results. And I'm understanding those results, but I actually really don't interpret them till I then go back and think about it in the actual learning context. And then that informs my interpretation of it. So it really is this give and take. And so I think as students of the science of learning, you want students to have this concept that they may sit in one place in the continuum of approaches most of the time, but that they really have to be thinking that this is a broad spectrum of approaches, and that their place in there is an important one, but it's one part of a much bigger machinery that's really going to work.